Now, in previous videos, I've spoken about being raised from the dead. What does that mean? Again, it means we recognize there is no such binding force as time, space, process, and form. None whatsoever. Form doesn't exist. It's all simply an appearance, being sustained by our desire for it. So Jesus, the great champion of freedom from death, clarifies for us how to be raised from the dead. In other words, raised out of that false belief system, raised out of the matrix, which is an agreement to structure appearance, to sequence appearance as if it were part of some process, time, space, duration, location, process, form. And yet it is not. That is a mirage. It is a self-deception. So Jesus is the great, great champion of those who want freedom. And he calls us being raised from the dead. He said, let the dead bury the dead, meaning let those who believe in time, space, duration, location, process, and form, let them deal with the issues that seem to arise in such a matrix, a belief-based matrix. But there's no reality to it whatsoever. Reality is simply whatever we desire it to experience is. That's reality. There's no two sides to it. So, can we be raised from the dead? Absolutely. Be ye raised from the dead. We all eventually will be. Being raised from the dead means the spell of this agreement that we have entered into, this belief system. The spell is broken, and we realize, wow, no, there's just appearances right here, right now. And that's all there ever is. So we see that death is impossible. It doesn't exist, actually. It doesn't exist one bit. We've agreed to try to make it seem realistic. So all nature, Mother Nature, may seem realistic. It's not real. It's a mirage. It's false. Now, those who, the rebellious spirits who want to maintain their misadventures of trying to be separate from God, be greater than God, have this belief system, and which they think will enable them to succeed, to be greater than God, and they want to strengthen this belief system. They feel the reason why it hasn't succeeded yet is this belief system is not strong enough yet. Well, how do they feel they make it stronger? Well, they aim to be oblivious to their true functioning, to our true functioning, what we desire to experience is. That's our true functioning. They say, no, everything has to go through a process, time, location, form, time, space, duration, location, form, process. And through that matrix, that's how you can gain happiness. That's the only way. And through doing that, what they're doing is they're trying to turn their back on their true functioning and become oblivious of it. Okay, as I've said before, we seek oblivion. We're seeking oblivion. We're trying to be oblivious to our true functionality. We're also trying to learn to identify threat. And this world lends itself to that totally. We want to be able to identify how it is that we're able to threaten reality and threaten the oneness. And, well, we didn't. We didn't threaten reality. Never have, never will. But we want to believe that we somehow are able to, but we just can't see how we did it. We have this picture of total chaos, which then we're defending against that with this matrix-like belief system. Now, the rebellious ones who want to maintain their misadventure of trying to be greater than God, they, again, want to double down on this belief system and try to reach oblivion to our true functioning and focus on identifying threat and trying to figure out how to solve threat, which means they identified it properly. They want to double down on it. They always want to double down on it. When they do so, they become very, very rambunctious and very closed-minded, very much into oblivion about their true functioning, and therefore they're oblivious to any teaching that points out their true functioning and how this matrix belief system is just illusion. Their minds are very shut for a while towards this. For a while. And just like the inmates gaining control of an asylum, they think they can cure themselves, and they end up just botching it so terribly, they say, wow. Eventually they just it's like a manic depressive. They go through a manic phase, and then they go through a depressed phase. And that's when you can say, hey, you know, let's stop going through this manic depressive cycle here. And then they gradually become receptive to truth. But during the manic phase, they may not be reachable. May not be reachable at all. And in fact, they may be downright dangerous as far as tempting others to believe in their belief system. Of course, we're all vulnerable to that here. Having a severe continuity problem, we are vulnerable to temptation. There's no question. This is why society needs to be structured in a way which minimizes temptation. We're all very vulnerable to it. And so during this manic phase, if the world should go into a severely manic phase, which I believe it will, it's a wise idea to step out of the way, get out of the way. Get out of the way, go somewhere, rest, relax, recuperate from the stresses, and get ready to help out when the manic phase is past. And where many spirits will repent and say, wow, that's enough of this. That's enough of this madness. But very few seem to be in a mood of repentance right now in this world. Very few. So it seems like there's going to be a big conflict and manic phase on this planet. Seems that way. This is what scriptures tell us. This is the end of the cycle. They tell us there's going to be just an incredibly intense manic phase here. We're told that Jesus has prepared a dwelling place for us, that we can go there. I've personally received an invitation to visit Jesus' house, his dwelling place. So I'm just assuming there is a dwelling place. It's a good assumption to make. It is an assumption at this point, but it's certainly one that's worth looking at. He says very close to where we are right now, very close. So I assume it's like Venus. You know, Mars, Venus, Mercury, Saturn, I don't know, Jupiter, you know, probably in this solar system. There's probably within this solar system a dwelling place for us, actually. Or it could be on like a huge mothership. I've heard the Venetians, fourth dimensional Venetians, have a massive, massive mothership. And they have scout craft or transport, you know, to transport craft to the mothership, etc. These other places are easily reachable within a very short duration, actually, through the kind of transport technology that is available, which is mind-based, actually. The ships are actually made by mind. The light, or the living light, and the mind, and they actually move through thought power, through mind power. So, it is very possible, you know, we could go somewhere else. It's very possible. Or there's someplace in this world, but I don't know, this world may be just sort of very much not a good place to be. It's possible. It's very possible. And I had this very key dream that showed me the future at one time, and it showed me this collapse that's coming and how I fled it and managed to reach a place and it was better than Earth. It was way better, way more beautiful and peaceful and serene, and just like, wow. I was just really, really impressed by the place, and I was made totally welcome there, totally honored and welcome. And they said, we know all about the troubles that you're having back there. I guarantee you, the people, those of other planets dwelling in other vibratory patterns, dimensions, they know about the problems here on planet Earth, for sure. It's a very well known, the situation on Earth is very well known throughout the cosmos, actually. Because this is where the rebellious ones are making a stand here. Those on this, hell-bent for misadventure. And they're turning this into one of their strongholds, this planet. At least that's what they have been moving towards. They want it to be, one of their central bases. And so it's not like the cosmos is, we're all alone and no one has a clue what's happening here. That's nonsense. Just as we are told in, by the media what's happening in the Middle East, Syria and Iraq, various places in the world, Ukraine. Here we are at a distance around halfway around the world, and we get reports, reporters are there, and we get these just almost immediately, so we can pretty much know day to day, hour to hour, what's actually taking place all over the world. Well, don't you think that cosmically there's also a capacity to be aware of what's happening all over the cosmos? Certainly like the solar system, you don't think that there's a capacity to know what's happening on planet Earth in different areas of the solar system? Of course there is. So we should never think that nobody knows, we're all alone, nobody knows what's going on here, and there's no recourse, no contingency plans, no one has done anything. If for instance, let's say there's a huge, huge war, or there's some conflict, and people have to flee the conflict. Refugees, it's called refugees. This has happened throughout history here. Well, we have various agencies to deal with refugee crises, like the Red Cross, for instance, International Red Cross. There are many agencies, that humanitarian agencies, that take in those who are fleeing conflict. Okay, on this planet, there are many such agencies. And so, they're very active, setting up housing, food, medicine, comfort, care for refugees. Now, do you think that the cosmos doesn't have agencies to deal with refugees from planetary meltdowns? Or is this just something that we invented here and has never been thought of before? Refugees, I mean, this is just like basic ABC stuff. So I was told in this dream, I went to another place and they said, we know all about what's happening on your plan, where you came from. We know all about it. Don't worry. You don't have to explain anything to us. I was thinking I have to try to like explain, wow. And they said, no, we understand perfectly well. No need to explain. You're perfectly welcome here. We totally honor, you being here. And we were expecting you. So again, if you have this super conflict in this world here, and the armies are going here, and then the people are fleeing, and you you know, satellite, you know, reporters, everything you can see is, you know, there's 200,000 people, a whole city is fleeing because they're being taken over by barbarians. You got a million people maybe flooding to a border of another country. You know, right then and there, you know, that, and you probably knew ahead of time of we better set up refugee infrastructure along this border area because it's very likely to be a lot of refugees coming here. Like, for instance, the partitioning of India into Bangladesh. Okay, well, it was actually partitioning of India into Pakistan and East Pakistan at that time. All right, so that's actually what happened. Pakistan, East Pakistan, which is now East Pakistan, is now Bangladesh after the War of Independence there. So there was a massive flood of refugees from what you would call East Bengal. There you now is now East Pakistan. A lot of Hindus, you know, fled the area and into India. And it's just, you know, so these things happen all the time. These things happen all the time. On a small scale and on a larger scale, a global scale, you can have a globe suddenly, you know, go in a direction that's very hostile to truth. And many people who have devotion to truth say, hey, this place is too hostile for us. We want to go, we want to flee this. So like the Hindus, they were fleeing from the regime of the Pakistani regime. And they feel that they weren't welcome there, they didn't fit in anymore. And, you know, they would lose their property, their wealth, their lives, quite likely. And so they said, we want to go somewhere where we're going to be welcome. So I think there's a parallel between what's happens in the world, and on a larger scale, is you can have a world that's taken over by a ideology, a belief system, which is fanatically against truth, which I call the secular materialist, the pagan secular materialist. Fanatically against God, against truth, against the way, the light and the way and the truth. Fanatically believing in form, process, time, space, duration, location. Fanatically believing in science. Fanatically believing that we're bodies. Fanatically believing that happiness comes through sensuality. Fanatically believing this massive pack of lies that truth aims and helps to dispel for us through our disciplines, our daily lives, our culture, our disciplines, which aim towards helping us generate momentum. And not only just maintaining momentum, but increasing momentum, and aims to minimize disruptions of that momentum. That's what a sane culture is all about. But we don't have that sane culture here very much in this world, and it's deteriorating very rapidly, exponentially. It's deteriorating, and so you have a climate of mockery in the world right now. And just like anything I can think of to say to the world, to any person, actually in person, I can't do it. Can't do it. There's way too much inhibition to do that. Because people just say, whoa, you can't say that. Like, oh, I can't be listening to that. You know, there is this like police state in the world already. Fundamentally, we live in a police state already on this planet. This is a police state planet. And I don't mean the good people like the highway patrol and the police who help keep our safety and keep the criminals away, and you know, they do a wonderful job. I'm not talking about that police. I'm talking about the thought police, the ideological police. That's the police state that we live in. Now, certainly there's a lot of private, you know, militia, private corporate thuggery, you know, which is, you know, people don't like, of course, that was used in You know, banana boat republics, etc. These big multinationals have their goons. And civilian, I mean, the police that help protect your neighborhood from crime. I mean, that's great. We're not talking about that. We're talking about the ideological police. That's a police state. You're not allowed to express yourself along the lines of true religious belief, true religious conviction, along the lines of being resurrected from the dead. You're not supposed to be, you're supposed to be in the closet, deep, deep in the closet, if you have beliefs about, you know, freedom, actual freedom. You're a pariah here. You know, it's just intense. There's a feeling you're a pariah. Nobody wants to feel like a pariah without any recourse or actual, not based on reason at all. It's a completely unreasonable position that's being advanced in this world. Based on a incredibly severe continuity fear it's unrecognized. In fact, it's so severe they think that's impossible to resolve, so it's better just to deny they even have it. Which then they double down on lies and deceptions and demand that everybody continue to agree that all appearance has to be, give the appearance of being bound by time, space, duration, location, form, process. That you're just demanding that you go along with that. And we have to say, no, absolutely not. We're not going to sacrifice our momentum towards freedom for anyone, for any reason, because there is no reason to do it. It's only those who have such a severe continuity fear that they think that oblivion is the only answer, which is to deny the Holy Spirit entirely. So we're not going to deny the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is capable of resolving the continuity fear in everyone without any exception. Therefore, those who seek oblivion and those who are doubling down on this and demanding everybody accept their belief that it's their continuity fear is so severe that it's unsolvable, so there's no point in even trying to. It's better just to deny that even reality even exists, that they believe they're bound to simply an arbitrary desire to pretend that there's time, space, location, duration, form, and process, to pretend that this is so, even though it's not. They believe that this is what everyone must do. Everyone must do this. They're denying God, they're denying the Holy Spirit, they're denying those who have been free of continuity fear, who can testify that the Holy Spirit absolutely knows the way and will stay with you forever and make sure that you succeed. They're in absolute ignorance, denial, and trying to turn their back on this and be oblivious to it. So the real problem here is oblivion, is obliviousness. And the intensity of this obliviousness is extreme. So we just have to rely upon those who are free of continuity fear, like Jesus, the great champion of our freedom, the great champion of our freedom, the great champion of the Holy Spirit, saying the Holy Spirit absolutely is your teacher. We have to rely upon their assessment of just how bad is this drive towards obliviousness, okay? Being oblivious of the way. Being oblivious of the way, as if that were our salvation. You know, if it gets too bad, you know, we have to rely upon their assessment. How bad is it? Now, my assessment is it's very bad, but my assessment is not the same thing as the assessment of the Holy Spirit. But I'm just doing the best I can in assessing this. Because again, momentum is absolutely key. It is far better to start all over again, where we can actually build momentum, than it is to try and prop up a situation where momentum is impossible. And what I've found is the rebellious ones, who are fostering this pagan, secular, humanistic ideology, what their goal is, they're very clever. Their goal is, again, to make it impossible to build any momentum. They don't deny you crumbs. You know, they just say you can't build any momentum on those crumbs. So they'll think, they preach tolerance. What they're really after is pretending to be tolerant, but they're totally intolerant of spiritual momentum. That's what they're completely intolerant about. And without spiritual momentum, you cannot succeed, and you're going to feel as if the continuity problem is impossible to resolve. Therefore, you're going to accept their ideology like it's better to double down on oblivion. That's what happens. Even though you may keep the accoutrement of religion and, you know, pretend like, well, yeah, I just want to have a couple symbols here, and at least I, you know, have a little picture there, and maybe I go to church once in a while and stuff. There's no momentum there. And the spirituality actually is momentum. It's not a static, stagnant thing. It's not a form. It is your momentum. That's what it is. What the secular humanist materialists want to do is to insist that we be satisfied with the form of religion, the form of spirituality, minus the momentum. Now, how is that going to get us raised from the dead? The dead meaning those who believe in time, space, process, form, duration, location. Those are the dead. They believe in death, actually. They believe in death. The death of reality. The death of reality is what they believe in. How are we going to get free of that if we don't have any momentum? And the answer is you can't. You cannot. Nobody can. So we have this horrible monster on this planet now of pretending that they're all liberated and educated and tolerant and they know a better way. And they're saying, look at all this form. Look at all this beautiful form we can have. Look at all these things we can have. Look at this form. Say, yeah. We like the form of religion too. Look at all these nice graphics we can do, this and this and that, buildings we can build. Sure, let's build another religious building. But everything is about form, process, form. Time, space, duration, location. It's the whole belief system. There's not one iota of real momentum being built up in such a situation. There's only the souring taking place and feeling that reality isn't worth anything. It's better to turn our back on it. And I'd say about entertainment too, it's damnation by faint praise, saying, yeah, here's the creativity, but this is as much as I can do. So you know what? That isn't really very good, is it? No. Okay, forget it. Forget creativity. Throw the baby out with the bathwater. The dirty bathwater of this world's entertainment. For instance, like Hollywood, we get to this point, we say, well, you know what, why may we just throw out all everything, throw out the baby too, the true, the divine child within us, throw that out too. Yeah, it's entertainment. Our creativity just isn't good enough. Let's double down on oblivion here, and let's worship idols and form. There's no momentum in that. There's no momentum in a world of idolatry. There's no momentum. Therefore, there's no success. So it is useless to hang out in a world where there's no momentum. You know, it's just spinning your wheels and getting burned out. So this whole thing is up to the decisions of those who know. You know, I'm just trying to tune into what is that decision and follow along with, you know, what those decisions are. As to maintaining momentum is all important. Maintaining momentum is all important on the spiritual path. That is the spiritual path. One moment, please. So essentially, we're on to the trick of the other rebellious ones, which is to break our momentum, but all the while offering us form. Here, take this form. Yeah, you can put this cross in your house, but can't do this and this and this and that. Or you can't go out, profess your faith. You cannot have any signs of faith to remind you. You cannot develop any momentum. Momentum is the path. Momentum is religion. Momentum is religion. That's what it's all about. It's never about the form. It's always about the momentum. And that is what they're directly attacking here in this world. So since we're wise to what they're doing, I think we're in a much better position now if we get some advice from our betters, those who don't have continuity fear, such as Jesus Christ. No continuity fear there. If we're better able to heed their advice, listen to what their advice is, knowing that momentum is the path, it is the way. You cannot sacrifice momentum for form. You will fall for sure. So I feel in a much better position now to listen and hear what's the advice. We need advice at this time. There's no question about it. I raised the issue of going to Venus, for instance, or someplace nearby. Certainly is a possibility. Remember, those who have no continuity fear, they've been raised from the dead. The belief in this dead forces which don't exist, binding forces of appearance which don't have any, the belief that appearances have some sort of binding force upon spirit which is the belief in death, and they have no binding force whatsoever. What we desire to experience is. So those who know this without any continuity fear at all, they are capable of manifesting anything, any appearance. Okay? And they can continue manifesting the appearance as a dwelling place instantly. They have no problem whatsoever. Our creativity is such we can manifest a whole universe like that. Okay, so certainly they can manifest a dwelling place for us instantly, actually. And the dwelling place would appear absolutely realistic in terms of a dwelling place. They know we have a need of a dwelling place. But we understand it would seem like supernatural. There would be a supernatural feel to it, which it feels it's all coming from love. And it's not trying to convince us that all this is bound by any forces. It is sustained by love and pragmatism for us. Okay. And certainly the difference is very noticeable. Because, of course, if we have a world, a dwelling place, we'll say, well, there seems to be duration, location, process, form, etc., like that. But then we realize, wow, everything here is like perfect. There's no threat. There's no death. There's nothing that we're aware that everything is made of light, that it's all made of thought and light, and it reflects our desire, simply our desire. It's a reflection of our desire to have a dwelling place while we work on our continuity fear. We're aware of that. Meaning each moment, we desire to continue for this appearance to appear as it appears. That's all. There is no process at all involved. No two moments are linked. There are no forms. We realize this is all appearance. In other words, nothing is bound to form. It is simply pragmatically appearing to give us, because of our continuity fear. All right, when we accept our continuity fear, we're able to accept a supernatural realm, actually. A realm that does not have the mother nature of process and all this, apparently. It's there, it's completely realistic, it's completely beautiful, and there are appearances that look like trees and mountains and plains and rolling hills and rivers and flowers and bushes and shrubs and, you know, butterflies. Everything, just very beautiful parkland-like setting. All that appearance is there. But we realize it's not, there's not all this mechanism of nature taking place, really. For instance, there's no reproduction taking place whatsoever. No reproduction of form. Everything that this appearing is a mere appearance through love. That love, the love of Christ, the love of our true spirit is desiring that this appearance be present for us, and so it simply is present for us. There's no attempt to deceive us into believing that there's some binding force like process where moments are linked, and that the appearance is a form, therefore, and it's not mere appearance and couldn't be anything else at any moment. There's no freedom, like it's bound into this form, and this form has to remain, you know, in the form through time, duration, through process, that things have to happen through forces of nature, through process. None of that's true. So dwelling in a supernatural world, you know, can you do it? Can you do it? I feel, yes, I could do it. I visited a supernatural world once in spirit, and it freaked me out after a little while. But I've had like a long time to get over that. You know, decades of trying to say, hey, you know, why did I freak out? I shouldn't have freaked out like that. And you just wonder, well, what's going on? Like, why is there no Mother Nature here? What, no process? You know, no. Will this remain? You know, it's like you're frightened. Of course, it will remain. It's based on our continuity fear. Our desire that we still feel as if there is something, a stable appearance that keeps appearing as it is, until we gradually regain our creative functioning, you see, until we gradually reacquaint ourselves with our functioning. But such a supernatural world enables us to maintain momentum. It means we are able to maintain great momentum there. And it's a piece of cake to get reacquainted with our true creative functioning. So I do know supernatural worlds do exist. They certainly do. Having visited one. And it was just like, wow. Really wow. the stature of the trees and shrubs, everything was just like majestic. Just absolutely majestic, and you just, you know, it gives you a pause and you just say, wow. The trees were like gigantic. Flawless. Everything was flawless. Everything was flawless, and not a trace of any trouble anywhere. No disease, sickness, decay. And I was aware that everything there had been there forever, so to speak, from the very beginning. So this is a manifestation. This is a manifested, supernatural manifested world. Okay. Now this world here is actually manifested too, but it's manifested in such a way as to give the impression that it's not manifested, that it's actually came about through process, through time, space, process, form, which is a deception. It is actually manifestation, but again, every effort has been made on our parts, collusion, to agree to a belief system so that it does not appear to be manifested. And so if you want to build momentum, it's not the best thing to be in a situation where everything colludes against you. You know, it's very difficult. It's difficult enough in this world to evaporate our continuity fear. It could become extraordinarily difficult based on this ideological conflict in the world. So, I received the invitation from Jesus directly saying, would you like to come visit my place? And I said, yeah, Absolutely I would. Done deal. Okay. It's that simple. It was just a simple question. Would you like to? And I said yes. That's it. That's how simple it was. And I wasn't the slightest bit afraid of that. I'm looking forward to it, actually. Very much looking forward to it. So, looking forward to the supernatural realm is where I believe we should be. At least our attention needs to be in that direction. Because at the very least, this brings up all the issues that we need to look at. It's kingdom of death. The kingdom of this death is this collusion. This matrix is a collusion that we have colluded on and out of fear to give the impression of forces that don't exist, which time, space, form, process, none of that exists. None of it exists. And yet, almost everyone here will insist that it must exist because the evidence seems to be everywhere. The evidence seems to be everywhere. We could easily prove otherwise, but our continuity fear locks us into it. If you have somebody doing miracles, people freak out and say, you got to kill that person. They're causing me, my continuity fear is unbearable. I think I'm going to be plunged into utter chaos. So, you know, we claim, well, where's the evidence that this is not true? You know, that what we think in time, space, duration, location, process, and form is not true. Where's the evidence? Everybody acts like they're real open-minded. They're not open-minded because the evidence has actually been here in this world, and yet they've paid no attention to it because their continuity fear directs their attention away from it like that. They cannot. Fortunately, I was able to pay attention to it. So I know very well that the evidence that this world, our beliefs, that there are these binding forces upon appearance are absolutely not true. The life of Sri Sri Anandamayi, which was from 1896 to 1982, okay, 1896 to 1982, which is the modern era, gave massive, massive evidence that none of these binding forces we're pretending are true. Massive evidence, incontrovertible evidence, and yet it's all ignored, completely ignored. That just shows you why continuity fear is too extreme. So you can't have it both ways. You can't demand that proof that these binding forces don't exist, and at the same hand, absolutely refuse to examine the evidence that is given. It's damned if you do, damned if you don't. Double bind, impossibility, right? That's not fair. That's not being fair at all. Pagans think they're being very fair. They're totally unfair, because they insist that unless you give them evidence that these binding forces of time, space, location, duration, form, process, unless you give them clear, compelling evidence that it's not true, they're completely within their right to insist that you agree that it is true. So when you give them the clear and compelling evidence that it is not true, they refuse to look at it, and then insist, well, you didn't give me any evidence, therefore you must be bound. How fair is that? That is the very definition of unfairness, isn't it? It's entirely 100% unfair. So they don't have any authority whatsoever to tell anyone what to do. If you're someone who's completely unfair, what authority do you have to demand that others bow to your demands? None. No authority. The rebellious ones have no authority to make such demands. So they may demand, you can't go to any supernatural world, it doesn't exist. Well, I say you refuse to even look, shift your attention to that. You refuse. And then you draw a conclusion that doesn't exist. No, you should just draw a conclusion that you refuse to shift your attention there because your continuity fear is too severe. But they say, no, they don't have any continuity fear. Why? Because they think it's so severe it can never be resolved. So this is these double binds. The pagan mind is in double binds. Very bad double binds, and they keep getting worse and worse. That's why they usually bottom out before they repent. So indeed, it is a tricky situation. But under no circumstances do the pagans have any authority to demand anything. Under no circumstances, they're functioning through double binds and insisting that's. It constitutes authority. It does not. It does not constitute any authority. It just means they have such a severe continuity problem that they feel it can't be resolved, which means they don't know the Holy Spirit. And that's their problem. You know, that's something that between them and the Holy Spirit that they have to come to a point where they realize, hey, what they're doing doesn't work. And we should not help them, encourage them to keep using these double binds as if they're going to work. So we have to say, no, not to the pagans. No, we're not going to encourage you to keep using double binds. We know the evidence exists, and therefore we know it is that all of its so-called binding forces are not real at all. They're not real. Therefore, why should we keep believing in that which is not doesn't exist and is not real at all? That's the only reason why we could possibly do that is severe continuity fear. And we've already repented and accepted we have a severe continuity fear. Therefore, we have every right to resolve this continuity fear, do everything possible we can to resolve the one and only problem we have. Totally fair. Totally fair. So we must insist upon fairness here. We must insist upon fairness, not double bindness. And they say, well, they may say, well, that's not fair to us. Oh, yes, it is, because it's showing you the way out of double binds. And that's totally fair. Showing you, yes, you can do it. Yes, the Holy Spirit does exist. And eventually, they got no choice but to recognize that the double binds and doubling down on insanity doesn't work. Again, don't try to convince them. Don't try to convince the unrepentant of anything, because all they have to offer you is double binds. I think most of you have already seen that, recognize it. It's very frustrating because they seem to be quite rational, but they're not. They're totally irrational because they believe in that double binds is fairness and that oblivion is salvation. It's just they appear to be quite rational and intelligent as far as using, you know, words go. They think, well, I can communicate with them. They're using words. No, that's just a front. That's just a front. That's just a front. They're irrational. Saying that there is no Holy Spirit is irrational. Claiming that something that doesn't exist is irrational. Claiming that something exists that doesn't exist is also irrational. Claiming that there's time, space, form, process, location, duration, that these are some sort of laws and forces that govern appearance is totally irrational, because none of those exist. None of those exist. And then claiming that there's no way to resolve your continuity fear because there's no Holy Spirit is also totally irrational, because the Holy Spirit does exist. Claiming that this world's the only dwelling place there is totally irrational, because supernatural realms certainly do exist, as well as other dimensional realms all over. And there's basically nothing but dwelling places in the cosmos. You know, it's all a dwelling place, really. In a lot of ways, you could look at it that way. Irrational. And so what I see is the world is become profoundly irrational. That's my experience in this world. The world was way, way more rational 50 years ago. Night and day, actually. Night and day. Now it is drastically more irrational, and yet much more trumpeting the triumph of irrationality as if it's some great triumph. You know, more and more and more you hear this boosterism and its celebration, like, wow, the victory of the irrational over truth, you know, like we're scoring a huge victory on this planet because the irrational is finally, you know, routed truth and fairness and rationality from this planet. Well, let them have their celebration. All right, we'll see how that works out for them. Let them work on their definitions, thinking that you know, driving us off the planet is ultimate victory. Well, of course, they want to define it that way, ultimate victory. What else can they say? It's just a manic episode. Manic episodes think, I'll always be this manic. You know, this is it. And then, poof, depression comes. Like, whoa. Then they sing a different song, don't they? They're saying, we proved that this is real. We proved there is no evidence. We proved that irrationality, you know, is the new truth. We've proved it because we're able to displace you, you know, see? Now, we're not being displaced. We're not being displaced at all. We're simply accepting a better place. That's not displaced. It's moving on up. We're moving on up here in our mission to, you know, try and help you build momentum, spiritual momentum. We're taking a slight break from that. That's all. And we'll be back and we'll be working to help you build up the spiritual momentum. But usually you need to hit rock bottom before you're willing to realize that momentum is king. And you have to structure a society, a world that supports momentum. Not the form of religion, but the momentum that religion can help generate by living a very chaste lifestyle, very disciplined lifestyle that is very dedicated, very chaste, disciplined, dedicated lifestyle, where you're not being distracted constantly by momentum busters. So it's, again, better to start all over, so to speak, from rock bottom and develop momentum than it is to try to prop up irrationality and all the pretense of fairness of this irrationality, which it engages in. The pretense of fairness that, here you've got the forms of religion, whatever, just no momentum. So that should satisfy you, right? That's a great compromise. You see how reasonable that is, how reasonable you have been, how reasonable we have been. We've come together in reason. That should mean that this kingdom here should be, we should all be happy. This is, you know, utter irrationality. Total illusion. But this is the New World Order teachings. That through this compromise of accepting form instead of momentum, form instead of content, that this will generate some golden age where everybody's going to be perfectly happy in a realm believing in body, world, time, space, location, duration, process, form, believing in all of that is true. Which is believing in death, which is turning your back on reality, which is damning reality with faint praise through all the entertainment activities we do, as if that constitutes our true the limits of our creativity, which is then to sour us on our true creativity altogether, to turn towards oblivion. All of that, they say that's the golden age. Turn our backs on God and our true functionality completely. Be oblivious of it. Accept this ludicrous exchange of momentum for form, and we should all be peaceful and happy here forever, ever after. This is the irrationality of insanity, of rebellious, misadventuring spirits who are inwardly frantic because of the continuity fear and not thinking that it's possible to solve it, so they act like fools. So this is how I see it. Nobody is sinful or wrong or bad. It's that the continuity fear for many is overwhelming, so severe, they feel there's no way they can solve it. They can solve it. They're unaware of the Holy Spirit. They're unaware of the Holy Spirit, as was I. So I've been through all this. When I bottomed out, I said, I can't go any further. I realized this is totally irrational, impossible. No way this will succeed, what we're trying to do. But I said, I don't know what else to do. I'm not a clue. I feel like totally forsaken. And I cried out for help. Is there any help? Holy Spirit, immediately, the presence was there immediately. I said, what's this? Some intelligence is here. Well, I don't know what it is. And then this intelligence said, don't worry. I will guide you and advise and guide you all the way to you'll be completely free of this horror, for sure, forever. And you will not fail. And I said, wow, what's this? I didn't even know. So I guarantee you that the rebellious, misadventuring ones are who have this continuity fear that's so severe that they believe it's impossible to solve, therefore they're totally justified in trying to turn their back on reality and go into oblivious of it. They feel justified in that. They're wrong. They're unaware of the Holy Spirit. They think that we have to do it through our intelligence, just through our intellect, and our cleverness, and our manipulativeness, and our deviousness, and slyness, and cunning, and deceit. That's how they think it has to happen. And it cannot happen that way. It cannot happen that way. As the Holy Spirit does subtle miracles along the path which build momentum for us. Without building momentum, you cannot succeed. You cannot. You will not have the confidence to break through the spell of the matrix and accept, wow, yeah, there are no binding forces, actually. There have never been. There have never been. There have never been. I am free. I'm not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me to be. The momentum, it takes momentum. Confidence. All important. So, if we just keep realizing this. So, we just rely upon the judgment of the Holy Spirit and Jesus and those who have no continuity fear at all. What to do? I don't know. I've not gotten exact, you know, blueprint for what to do. I hope I get one. I hope I get one and can share it somehow. Because again, what I feel is the momentum, spiritual momentum of this planet is what I see is it's being fragmented and broken up, and we're getting all this form, religious form, you know, which is a deception because the momentum isn't there. You can feel the momentum if it's there. You can feel it. You say, wow, this has got momentum. This has momentum. When you're paying attention, when your attention is on something, if it's got momentum, you know, you will feel it. You will feel it. You know, all these people going to the yoga classes and stretching and I'm getting so toned and looking so incredible. My body's so beautiful. Like you can't, you know, it's stale, it's stagnant. You don't feel the momentum. So I'm looking at the world. Where's the momentum here? Where's, like, it's like disappearing. Where's the momentum? It's like vanishing. Like water in a desert. Where'd it go? So, now, a lot of people believe that there is a ton of momentum and that everyone's becoming enlightened. Is that true? Are they becoming more and more adept at posing in the form of enlightenment, is the question. That's how I see it, is the world is now turned towards mastering the form of enlightenment. Posing as the form of enlightenment without the content. You know, they're becoming adept at that, actually. And those are the ones saying, don't worry, we're headed towards a golden age. Everything will be fine. Burning off all the karma. Everything's going to be great. Questionable. Very questionable, actually. Highly questionable. I mean, I've always questioned it. I said, wow, something just doesn't feel right with the forms that we're getting of spirituality in this world. Because when you compare it with something that you know from someone who has zero continuity fear, and you get the teaching from them, and you take that, and then you compare it to the other stuff, you say, wow. You know, one seems living with momentum, the other seems to be stagnant with form. I say, what's going on here? Well, this great compromise is what may be going on, this great deceit. Compromise is the code word for busting up momentum and settling for the pretense of form. That's what it really means. Again, there are no two sides to truth. There's no compromise to truth. There's no two sides to it. We have to evaporate our continuity fear. That's not compromise. That's pragmatism. And pragmatism is all about building up your momentum, not about breaking it up and handing you form. It's not about that at all. So if you can get some feel, full stop in the feel of what's being shared here, full stop in the feel of that, like, wow. Yeah, momentum is king. Momentum is success. We have to succeed. Compromise is not success. It's a code word for failure. Compromise is a code word for failure. I don't have a compromise problem, I have a continuity problem. Okay, the ego, the rebellious, the ideology and belief system of the rebellious, misadventuring ones is, their ideology is compromise, meaning no momentum. Trade your momentum in for some glamorous form of spirituality, some glamorous pretense of enlightenment. But no momentum. They're terrified of momentum. They're like allergic to it. Phobic of it, momentophobic. I call these people, they're momentophobic. Profound, we have a world that is full of momentophobic fools, claiming that they have some divine right to rule over you and force you into following, you know, bowing to their demands. Momentophobic, afraid of momentum. No prayer in school, no worship in public, no signs of, you know, those things that remind us that momentum is all important. No reminders of momentum anywhere. Only models of form. Saying, look how wonderful it is to settle for form over content. That's what this world of marketing is all about, corporate marketing in this world. Look how wonderful it is to settle for form instead of content. Wow, aren't you so fortunate? Aren't you so blessed that you realize you can settle for form over content? That's a lie. You can never settle for form over content. There's no such thing as form. You can never settle for nothing. How can you settle for nothing? You always feel an uneasiness within, like, wow, this isn't it. So we continue to press forward with assessing our options, wisely assessing our options. What's off the table is sacrificing momentum, sacrificing the Holy Spirit, but that's off the table. That's never on the table, okay? Never on the table. That's not going to happen. It's only where can we maintain our momentum and increase our momentum. And if this world is the best place to increase our momentum, great. If it's not, go somewhere else. If it's available to us. That's all. Total reasonable, totally fair. So let's avail ourselves of what is reasonable and fair, and let's just ask Jesus a simple question. Jesus, what is the best way to keep our momentum, to build upon our momentum, and be truly successful, to be raised from the dead? That's our goal, to be raised from the dead, absolutely. It's everyone's goal. In fact, it's more than a goal, it's everyone's absolute necessity. There is no death. There is no form, space, time, space, location, duration, form, process. Nothing binding to death at all. There's nothing binding anything to death at all. Therefore, there is no death, actually. It's just like this collective collusion of self-deception We have no choice. We have no choice in this whatsoever. So it's all a matter of what's the best way to get it done as soon as possible. So we just ask Jesus, we just ask you to advise us on this. Advise us on this so we're aware and we can move forward confidently right now. Because right now, you got like the jitters about this world. It's like, what's going on here? What is going on? Like, wow, I don't trust the situation. There's a lot of us that don't trust what's going on in this world. It seems like they're hell-bent on throwing out the baby with the bathwater. And deep down, a lot of us who have built up some momentum are saying, whoa. Wait a minute here. This isn't what we want. You're going to press this upon us? Okay. Well, hasta la vista. Until we meet again. Right? Under better circumstances. I hope we meet again. We will meet again under better circumstances for sure. Where we both believe in momentum and value momentum. Right? Instead of just one of us, the other saying not. We'll meet again where we both value it. And so the one value I can say momentum is the one value that we all have to value. Momentum towards evaporating our continuity fear. For sure. And the value of the Holy Spirit. That is not on the table of any sort of discussion and negotiation. Never will be. Never will be. Cannot be. Cannot. Inherently cannot be. Because if you try to take it off, you just have to revisit it again. And revisit it and revisit it and revisit it until you finally realize you can't take it off the table. There are no forces that bind us. We're spirit. We're free. Whatever we desire to experience is. And that's all there is to it. So, this has been a little pep talk, a little clarification, understanding the situation of the world, understanding how they use these double binds on us, how they're actually demanding we sacrifice momentum and the advice of the Holy Spirit and those who are free of the continuity fear, for example, the great champion of freedom, Jesus Christ. They're demanding all of that as if this is some fair compromise, which it is absolutely, completely unfair. To everyone, totally unfair. No compromise at all. It's total unfairness. It's designed to turn us towards oblivion. So clarify all of this. Let it sink in a full stop. Just get the feel of it. Don't try to rush out and say, hey, I think I know a way now to be free of all this, because it's more severe than we realize. We realize they believe they can't solve their continuity problem. It's too severe. We realize that's not true. We know. See, I know it's not true because I've bottomed out. And I thought I'm in a situation that's impossible to solve. And the Holy Spirit said, no, not any problem at all for me. No trouble at all. I said, wow, what? And to me, it's impossible. The Holy Spirit says, no trouble at all. Just, I'll show you. So I know for a fact that there's no such thing as a continuity fear so severe that it cannot be resolved. It's impossible. Holy Spirit will resolve all continuity fear. And it has to be resolved. So, knowing that, I know those who insist otherwise are simply mistaken. And mistakes do not build momentum. Okay? Mistakes unacknowledged do not build momentum. Mistakes acknowledged do build momentum. So when we live in a world where nobody's willing to acknowledge their mistakes, where's the momentum? There's no momentum. They want to deify their mistakes. That's not momentum. That's stagnation. Designed for oblivion. So again, let this sink in. And still, of course, it's not enough. We need some advice. But this is a step towards that. At least I'm broaching the topic here. And we're, you know, really getting, laying down the justification and the groundwork for it all here. And don't try again to apply it to the real world immediately. Let it sink in first. Let it sink in and say, you know what, I'm comfortable with this standpoint, from this taking this stance. I'm comfortable taking this stance. And let that get a comfort zone with it first before you try to stand up to the world, because the world will want to crush you like a bug right now. Crush you like a bug. So don't be, you know, mouthing off to people, and let yourself get very, very comfortable with all this. And remain humble. And remember, we have a severe continuity problem. Thank God the Holy Spirit is there for us. and advisors, free of all continuity of fear, are our friends. They're not only our advisors, they're our friends. They come in friendship. They come in fraternal friendship of spirit, spiritual friendship. Saying, I know, they know we're spirit too, that we're not bodies, they know that. So they come in this gracious, loving friendship of, we will advise you. Okay, so we're wide open, all ears to what's the best way, what's best for our momentum? All right, what is best for our momentum? And then we say, okay, all right, that's it for this one.